arriving in Tokyo at night and heading downtown is one of the world's more bewildering architectural experiences. Coming from Europe, you're immediately struck by how relentlessly modern everything seems. In Britain, we tend to find this kind of landscape rather frightening. We've tended, particularly in our houses, to retreat from such a vision of full-on modernity into what I've been calling a pastiche version of our rural past. I've come to Japan to experience a very different approach. Does wholeheartedly embracing the modern world, as the Japanese seem to do, always have to mean losing touch with the traditions of your culture?
The dilemma facing Japanese architects is actually one that all architects face nowadays all over the world, and it's really this. How do you put up a building that avoids being bland and universal, and at the same time isn't going to be kitsch or an attempt to suggest that the modern world just never happened? How do you avoid the dichotomy between, on the one hand, a kind of global colourlessness, and on the other, a sort of Disney World pastiche? Really, the ideal is, how can you create a building that manages to be both historically sensitive and yet distinctively and gloriously modern?
At first glance, Tokyo doesn't look very promising. The buildings are mostly anonymous and international, as if they could be in Frankfurt or Detroit. It's hard to see what's particularly Japanese about much Japanese architecture anymore. To get an idea of what Japanese architecture used to look like, you have to get out of Tokyo. I visited an old-fashioned ryokan, or inn, up in the hills. Surrounded by bamboo forests and a moss garden, it's the kind of place where the Japanese have come to unwind for centuries. The interiors are simply, austerely furnished, with paper shoji screens, creating the diffuse light and the sense of harmony between the interior of the building and the natural world outside that are the hallmarks of traditional Japanese architecture.
What's astonishing is the precision in everything. There seems to be a theme running through everything, from the food, to the way people bathe, to where the room is laid out. It's just a complete, coherent aesthetic and really a kind of way of life. There's that feeling you sometimes get when something is so extremely beautiful, the rest of life can't quite live up to it. And as I prepare to go to sleep here, I suppose one of my regrets is why the rest of Japan and Tokyo is not anything like this. And I wonder if there is anywhere where the spirit that you see here is to be found in a more modern form, or whether this is just some beautiful piece of archaic tradition which hasn't really lived on into the modern world.
Plastic House was built in 2002 on a typically cramped urban Tokyo plot by the architect Kengo Kuma for Roland Kirishima and his family.
Hello.
Hi, Roland.
Yokoso.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. Come on in.
Wow, so you just drive straight in.
Yep.
Very convenient place to park. So this is called a plastic house.
Yes.
How did you decide to build a house out of plastic?
Well, our first plan was to actually build a whole structure with plastic, you know, even the sidewalls, and like a Lego house, you know, but unfortunately the law didn't allow us to, build it throughout the whole thing without the using any, pillars. So we ended up, you know, using it in the facade, in the front facade and the back facade.
Roland is a fashion photographer and as modern a person as you're ever likely to meet. but his house has a simplicity and a translucent monochrome purity you might associate with a traditional Japanese religious building.
Wow. So you've got a gravel garden,
yes.
Traditional temple-style gravel garden,
yes.
And a moss garden, a tiny little moss garden.
Yes, we're going to probably eventually put another, how do you call it, a water bowl, you know, so we could wash our hands for the tea ceremony.
Of course, even though it looks like an extremely modern house, actually,
yes.
You're thinking about a lot of the traditions,
yes.
of Japan.
In the West, we tend to think of this kind of Zen minimalism as a luxurious style option, the set dressing of choice for Prada stores and boutique hotels. But here, it's a philosophy and a way of life.
So this is the master bedroom.
Gosh, very peaceful.
Yeah.
What happens after?
Zen Buddhists believe that we need our houses to create a refuge from the clutter and distraction of daily life. Not in order to hide from reality, but precisely to come closer to its central truths. And yet the miracle of this house is that it's all been achieved by the most uncompromisingly contemporary of materials, plastic. The Lunchbox House is home to Noriyuki Shibata, a television sports producer, his wife and their children. Mr. Shibata wanted his house to reflect the centrality in his life of two great Japanese loves, food and lying for hours on end in a hot bath. The entire top floor of the house is given over to a space where Shibata-san can luxuriate in a bath open to the elements. And the connection with food is something Shibata-san explained to me over lunch.
This is my house.
Although it looks modern, the house is based on an ancient idea. With its three open-plan floors stacked neatly on top of each other, its architectural plan is derived from the traditional Japanese lunchbox.
Many of Japan's houses are marked by extremely simple furnishings, reflecting a long-standing pull in Japanese aesthetics towards austerity and emptiness. In pre-modern Japan during the Momoyama and Edo periods, even the great lords and wealthy merchants would often leave behind their castles and mansions and head to a simple hut in the hills in obedience to the Zen Buddhist command that spiritual enlightenment could only come through a life entirely without embellishment.
Despite its location in the heart of a distracting city, while having a bath in the lunchbox house, it might be easier to remember those ancient lessons in simplicity. The emptier the rooms, the more certain truths may be visible.